together this morning to remember, to celebrate, to give thanks to God for the life of Peggy Gurski. Also to seek the consolation of the Holy Spirit, the comfort of the Spirit, the comfort of is the Word of God in our grief. On behalf of the family, let me say welcome and thank you so much for being here today to honor Peggy's life. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." And in Psalm 62 we read, "Find rest, O my soul, in God alone. My hope comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. On God rests my salvation and my glory. My mighty rock, my refuge is God. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us." Let's go to the Lord now in prayer. Please join me. O God, you who are our God and our Father's God, you whose compassions fail not, but are the same yesterday, today, and forever, grant us now your presence, we ask, that our souls may be strengthened, that we may find all grace to help in this our time of need, which we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit we will ascribe all honor, majesty, and might, world without end. Amen. Lamentations 3, beginning in verse 22, says, "The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him." We're going to sing together now a hymn taken from those words. "Great is thy faithfulness." Peggy, I know, loved the singing of the saints. And so I ask you even to honor her, and of course, more so, her God and Savior, by singing with us. The words are printed in the order that you got on your way in. So would you please join us in singing, "Great is thy faithfulness."
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father.
us. Corey's going to come now and say a few words.
Greetings in the name of Jesus Christ. I'm very thankful for everyone that's made today. All the kids that, great-grandkids, everyone that's friends and family, great thankful. Mom was born in Bethany, Oklahoma on March 23rd, 1934. She was 89. Thought she was going to hit that 90. Growing up in Oklahoma and attended Bethany Nazarene College, Peggy has been the loving, caring matriarch of our family, guiding so many of us to Christ out of her love for Christ. She's done so much, especially for me, but I'm not the only one that can brag. Mom's done wonders. She went to be with the Lord on one of her favorite holidays, 4th of July, when I was going through pictures, looking for some of the pictures that we displayed. It was amazing, all of the 4th of July's at the lake, where every one of us has been, it seems like, and had a lot of fun. I started looking through pictures and then started sending pictures to everybody as I was going. And 2 in the morning, it was, I said, oh, I better stop texting people. there was a bunch. It was always wonderful and amazing that she passed away on July 4th. And we get to celebrate her being in heaven. I just wondered. Mama lived, Jim lived in Anna, and they've been loving it there. They love their church, Grace and Peace Presbyterian Church. Of course, their pastor. There were so many that have, she's left with joy in her hearts, in our family. She was preceded in death by her dad, Fred Hoover, and Velma Bullock, her mother. Brother Dwayne passed away not too many years ago, and Mike more recently, and Tobin, Tyler's twin brother, passed away quite a few years ago now, but we can't forget him. He's a wonderful man, and by far the best looking one in the family. Red will argue that. She has still with us our Kathy and her Marcia and her husband Greg, Jim of course, and sister Jane Schlubach. I believe Matt's even here today, all the way from somewhere far away, New York, and then recently Vegas, or LA. Me, of course, and my wonderful wife, Cheryl, Kim and her husband, Barry, Brett and Becky, and, of course, all our kids and Tyler, Yvonne, Jessica Hoover, and Josh Gurski, and his loving, and I put that loving wife, Ashley, I had to add that. I sure did. Not that the others don't love us, but she shows that love all the time. Peggy is also survived by a wonderful host of grandchildren. Whew, too many to name, by far. And in this list, and I was thinking of something when I wrote this about the blessings that God puts upon the families of those that believe. And that Ten Commandments, right at the end it says, "And showing mercy to thousands who love me and keep my commands." Exodus 26. That was appropriate for my mother. Very appropriate. I thank you all for coming. I thank everyone for my mother, for being her friend, loving, caring. Her heart, as most of you know, was so strong and just guiding us in love. We didn't deserve it, just like Jesus does. Thank you all very much. I've got to tell you, this is her grandson, the preacher. He's our first preacher in our family that I can remember well. My dad's side had a bunch. Josh, Eric is wonderful. Josh and Ed
Grandpa and I were discussing scriptures that come to mind as you think about Grandma and just the type of woman, the type of person she was. And of course, if you know it, a very popular, famous section of scripture from Proverbs 31 definitely comes to mind. I'm going to read it here. It's long, but just listen to these words. "An excellent wife who can find. She is far more precious than jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not harm all the days of her life. She seeks wool and flax and works with willing hands. She is like the ships of the merchants. She brings her food from afar. She rises while it is yet night and provides food for her household and portions for her maidens. She considers a field and buys it with the fruit of her hands. She plants a vineyard. She dresses herself with strength and makes her arms strong. She perceives that her merchandise is profitable. Her lamp does not go out at night. She puts her hand to the distaff, and her hand holds the spindle. She opens her hand to the poor and reaches out her hand to the needy. She is not afraid of snow for her household, for all her household are clothed in scarlet. She makes bed coverings for herself. Her clothing is fine linen and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sits among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them. She delivers sashes to the merchants. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she laughs at the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many women have done excellently, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands and let her works praise her in the gates." As you read those, there are so many things that stand out, especially as you think about Grandma Peggy. The first is, over and over, it talks about this hard working, this diligence, this organization, this excellent wife, this excellent woman, this excellent mother has. I mean, Grandma, there is no doubt she was a hard worker. I mean, she raised 8 children. If you know much about her story, they had 3 kids and then they had twins. I cannot imagine twin boys after already having 5 kids, 2 of them babies, being twins, raising that, getting them out of the house, and now we're gonna adopt, we're gonna raise more children at a time when most people are just excited to start schooling their grandkids. She says, "You know what? God has called me to something more special, and that is to raise up more children in the Lord." I know many of us, kids, grandkids, a lot of us at some point in our lives worked at the photo lab. And if you know, Grandma handled the books. And so, it was kind of nice to be her favorite grandkid, so I got a little grace. But for most of us, you better get that timesheet in on time, because she's going to call you the second it's not there. She's gonna watch that. And it was funny, you know, she did the books. Grandpa, he's the dreamer. You know, he had all kinds of crazy ideas. This, Jim, we can't afford that. Oh. And you go stay at her house there at the lake, and, you know, you go there to go fishing and do all these fun things. And, of course, we did all of that. But Grandma made sure if there was work to be done, that it got done. And, you know, I just picture her with a bandana around her head, a nice cold rag on her shoulders. We were going to do some yard work. We were going to stain the wood for the lake room. We did crash lawnmowers into trees. We had all kinds of things. But, man, she was going to make sure that we worked hard. I learned many, many lessons of hard work and diligence from her example. Not only does this scripture discuss hard work, but wisdom. If you don't know much about our family, we are a family of talkers. Amen? And very opinionated talkers, I might add. And look, Grandma was not afraid to share her mind. She would tell you what she felt. And most of the time, she was probably right. But her wisdom wasn't just in the words she shared. She had a very special gift, and that was to listen. And as I picture her so many times, sitting, legs crossed, her feet on her knee, head turned, and you knew that when you talked to her, whatever you said, she heard it, and she listened, and she cared. So many of us are so worried about what the next thing we're going to say. And Grandma definitely showed her wisdom in caring for what others had to say. Grace and mercy. As a family, every one of us have done foolish, 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 foolish things. And Grandma, you know, she definitely just has that poise. Grandpa would say she's a lady. And it always feels terrible to let a lady down. I know I did at times. I know many of us did. And yet, Grandma, she saw the best in us, even at our worst. Words of mercy when we were definitely not deserving it. Encouragement and forgiveness over and over and over for so many of us. And she just had just that gift from God. She always saw our potential. And lastly, and definitely most importantly, is faith. Grandma spent many years doing prison ministry. Miss Peggy, to all the prisoners, I'm sure they got tired of so much R.C. Sproul, but I know she didn't, because she was always there to share some new study or book or something. There's a picture we went through, and it didn't make it in the list, but it's Grandma and Grandpa, R.C. Sproul, just smiling so big, and then like a teenage Josh that's like, I cannot believe you dragged me to this. Oh, goodness. Our heart and love for so many of those men, that they would find Christ. For us as a family, she prayed for each and every one of us diligently. And if you ever, you know, you went to visit her, she always would tell you or ask about somebody else in the family, because she just cared so deeply, loved so much. Every one of us she was praying for. Getting up early to do it. A few years ago, sitting next to Grandma watching my kids. We were watching my children. don't know why, but she just looked at me and she said, "Derek, I wish I was a Christian sinner." I said, "Well, what?" She said, I wish that I had been a Christian sinner." I said, "Grandma, I know a lot of people that were Christians a lot sooner than you were. But a lot of them do not have the conviction and the faith and really understand what a joy of the Lord is. So many of us, myself included, take a lot of our faith for granted, and yet Grandma didn't, because I think she wasn't a Christian sooner, so she knew it. And I told her that, and of course her answer was, "Well, I still wish I was a Christian sooner." Grandma probably mad at me for saying so much about her, because she definitely would want the direction to be on our Savior Jesus Christ, who rescued her, who rescued so many of us in the family through her. And it's by that faith that we know that she's in the arms of her Savior today. We're going to miss so many things about Grandma. And it's okay for us to shed some tears. But man, it's a great feeling to know exactly where she is today. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Derek. Well, we're going to sing again. So please join me in singing "He Leadeth Me," which is there on the back page of your order for today.
He leadeth me. I can't think of a more appropriate hymn for Peggy, his faithful follower all these many years. As Derek and I were talking with Jim on Wednesday about scriptures, as Derek said, he mentioned Proverbs 31. He also mentioned Psalm 103. He shared with us that this is the scripture that the Lord used to awaken Peggy to the gospel, to open her eyes to his marvelous grace in Jesus Christ. And so what better scripture for us to read and consider together this morning than this passage that led her to that grace that so grounded, strengthened her life all these years. And so let me read for us Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel. Hear this. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. For he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. As for man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like a flower of the field, for the wind passes over it and it is gone, and its place knows it no more. But the steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him, and his righteousness to children's children, to those who keep his covenant and remember to do his commandments. The Lord has established his throne in heaven, in the heavens, and his kingdom rules over all. Bless the Lord, O you his angels, you mighty ones who do his word, obeying the voice of his word. Bless the Lord, all his hosts, his ministers who do his will. Bless the Lord, all his works in all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Lord, that is God's word. So thankful for it on this day. I can't tell you what a great privilege it is to get to open up the word at Peggy Gurski's funeral. So thank you to the family for allowing me to do this. I've told a number of the family that if they would have let me sweep the floors today, I would have been honored because Peggy was such a wonderful woman. When I think about her life, think of a life wonderfully lived. And that's been testified to by a son and by a grandson up here, and so many in this room would testify to that. Peggy is one of the most godly women that I ever met. Even as I look around the room and see so many whose lives she has impacted in a meaningful and a positive way with the gospel of Jesus Christ, with love, with patience, with forgiveness, as has been testified today. But the two things I think most of are joy and peace. I knew Peggy in the later years of her life. Jim and Peggy came down about 11 years ago, and I've had the privilege of being their pastor for these 11 years. And through times of difficulty, physical ailments, family worries, just aging, she has shown joy and peace. And not a surface happiness exactly, but yeah, sure, but a deep, an abiding joy. And not an avoidance of difficulty or ignoring of hard things, but a true peace that passes understanding. Now think about the words of Jesus to his disciples in the upper room found in John 14, where he said to them, after he had told them that he was about to leave them, and that one of them was going to betray him, and they couldn't go with him in this moment, so in a hard moment for them, he says, believe in God, believe also in me. Sorry, I got ahead of myself. First he said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. I know that there were things that troubled Peggy's heart. In my experience, it was mostly things about other people and not about herself. I prayed with her and at her bidding for many, many of you in this room, whether it was a physical ailment, an emotional ailment, a spiritual ailment. She cared deeply about these things, and yet, in a very real and overarching way, her heart was not troubled, because she knew exactly where to take her troubles. Just as Jesus says there in John 14, believe in God, believe also in me. It was the bedrock of Peggy's life. It was the bedrock that she desired for every one of you in this room who knew her. It's the only source of true and abiding joy and peace for our lives. And so consider just those two statements today. No matter where you are, how you're processing this, and the grief, and the missing that Peggy, our dear sister and loved one, believe in God. Believe also in Jesus. And so he says, believe in God. Who is this God that he would call us to believe in? We heard a beautiful description of God there in Psalm 103, particularly in verse 8, where he says, the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. And there's so much packed into that statement, but begin with the name. The Lord. That's Lord in all capital letters. That refers to the personal name of God, Yahweh in the Hebrew, or Jehovah, if you like kind of the older pronunciation of it. And it's a name that comes from the verb to be. And so when God says his name to his people, he says, I am. He is God. He simply is. He has no beginning and he has no end. He is the very source of all life and existence. All things were made by him in the word of his power and for his glory. All things continue to exist by his sustaining mercy. He is all-knowing. He is all-powerful. Nothing is outside of his control. And he is holy. We heard that at the very beginning of the psalm, didn't we? Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. He is perfect. He never gets anything wrong. Never. There's no shadow of wrong in God. He is holy, and he is perfect. And so when Jesus says to his disciples, to us today, believe in God, he's not talking about some empty idea. He's not talking about some feel-good idea. He's talking about this God who is eternal and unchanging, who we have heard today is a rock and a refuge and a fortress, because he is God and he has always been and he will always be, and he is all-powerful and he is all-knowing and he is holy and he is good, and we can trust him. And thus Jesus says, believe in him, not just believe that he is, but entrust yourself to this God, for he is a refuge. And that's the second half of this statement here, isn't it? The Lord, this one we've been talking about, is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Somehow this God who is perfect in his holiness and his righteousness and his justice, who knows all things, he knows everything we've ever done, everything we're doing right now and everything we will ever do. Somehow this God, who knows these things about you and me, looks upon us with mercy and grace, love that abounds to the heavens. And that's truly astonishing, isn't it? Because every one of us in this room knows that we haven't lived a life worthy of that God. Every one of us in this room knows that we have fallen short of His glory. We have rebelled against Him in some way, actually in many ways. Whether that is in the forefront of your consciousness and you know it, or it is hidden deep in the recesses of your heart, you still know it. You have failed this God and you are deserving of His wrath because you have. And yet, He looks upon us with mercy and grace and love. In fact, this is not simply something God does begrudgingly because He has to, as it were. You may not know this, but David here is not simply reflecting on who God is. He's actually quoting who God says He is in these words. In Exodus 33, Moses says to God, "Show me your glory." And there's a lot of context in that moment. But as God says, "You can't handle all of my glory," he says, "But I will hide you in the cleft of a rock, and I will pass before you, and I will proclaim my name to you." And when God speaks His name, He says, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. This is who God is at His very core. How can this be? How can this God, who is holy and just and perfect at the same time, be merciful and gracious? How can He, as Psalm 103 says, not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities? How can this be? This is why Jesus says, not just believe in God, believe also in me. Of course, Jesus is not saying He's not God. We know that He is. He's the very Son of God. But He's emphasizing what it is that He has come to do when He says, believe in God, believe in His holy and powerful and wonderful God, believe also in me. You see, because He is the very Son of God who has taken on flesh, who has become a man so that He can live a perfect life on this earth, the only one who ever lived without sin, and yet die upon a cross, bearing the sins of His people, bearing our sins. Apostle Peter says He bore our sins in His body upon the tree, upon the cross. And as the very Son of God who was perfect and had never failed His Father, never looked away from His Father, had never fallen short of the glory of His Father, as He dies upon the cross with our sins upon Him, He takes all of God's wrath for our sins. All of the punishment that we deserve for our sins is laid upon the very Son of God so that we escape every single bit of it. So that David can say here in verse 12, in this verse that so revolutionized Peggy's life, as far as the east is from the west, so far does He remove our transgressions from us. God, as it were, gathers our sins up and lays them upon Christ, so that in His sacrifice, in His death, and His resurrection, they can be taken so far away from us that they are never counted to us again. And we don't face the punishment for them. We can hear the words and live in the words. There is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For our sake, God made Him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God. It is because Jesus knows that this is what He has come to accomplish that He says to His disciples, believe in God, believe also in me. And then He goes on to say these beautiful words, in my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may also be. Because he died and rose again, he has opened the way for us to heaven so that we can live with our God in communion forever in glory. That is our greatest source of hope and comfort in life and death, that Jesus Christ lived, died, and rose again for our salvation. I cannot tell you how sweet it has been to spend time with a family in the hospital this week who was sad, yes, because they were loving one, losing one who had loved them so dearly. And if they loved, so did we. We were sad because we were losing one that we have loved and has loved us so dearly. And yet, a family that was not troubled, a family that was not anxious, because they knew for certain that these words are true. And that Peggy laid her life upon them. She trusted in this God and in this Savior. And because of his strength and because of his grace and because of what he had done, there is absolutely no doubt that she is in one of those rooms that Jesus has prepared. That she is delighting in the face of the Savior that she's so delighted in through a veil here upon earth, and I believe is singing in a whole new way, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Let me just be very clear, because she would want me to be very clear about this. Not because she was a wonderful wife, and a wonderful mother, and a wonderful grandmother, and a wonderful aunt, and a wonderful friend. She was, but not because she made herself worthy, but because her God is so gracious, and he has given his very son to accomplish this salvation in her behalf. And she would want me to plead with you today, believe in God and believe in Jesus Christ. Throw yourself upon his mercy as you grieve, to know and in great hope and assurance that she is with him. And if you trust in him, you will join her. And if you grieve without that hope, to hear it today and to turn to him in faith and to know this peace and to know this assurance and to know this joy and to know this everlasting life that so grounded this life wonderfully lived. Believe in God. Believe also in Jesus Christ. Let me pray and ask the Lord to help us to do this. O Lord Jesus Christ, you who wept at the tomb of your dear friend Lazarus, you know our grief. And we thank you that we can trust that. You who tell us to grieve, but not as those without hope, for you have died and you have risen and ascended to the right hand of God that we might join you there. You who say that you will never leave us nor forsake us, but that you shower love upon us at all times. Oh God, be near to your people. Be near to these, your children. Be near to Jim. Be near to all the children, all the grandchildren, all the great-grandchildren, all the other family, sisters, all friends who grieve the loss of one that we so admired, that we so loved, and who so loved us. Lord, be near. Grant us your peace. Grant us your grace. Grant us your hope, for we know that you are good, that you care for your people. Thank you again for the hope that we have in Christ Jesus. We pray in his name. Amen. Now, going to listen to one of Peggy's favorite songs, How Great Thou Art, and I guess Carrie Underwood sings it, one of her favorite versions of it. So now, listen and think about this great hope that we have in Christ. Thank you. Amen. We're going to be heading over in just a moment to Highland Cemetery in Melissa for the burial. Before we go, receive the benediction from the Lord. Well, I mean, before that, again, thank you for being here today to honor Peggy's life, to support the family. Hear now benediction from the Lord. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.
Let's open with a quick word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you. Thank you for a beautiful day, Lord. It's warm, it's hot, but Lord, it's a beautiful day as we celebrate the life of Grandma Peggy Gerson. Lord, in all things, let us just remember her, rejoice in those memories, and Lord, celebrate knowing where she is. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it's not a surprise to anyone. I think we're all in agreement that the world is a broken place. When sin first entered the world, when Adam and Eve took the bite of the fruit that they were forbidden, the world was broken, a place of turmoil, a place of anger, of hostility, and death. And I think God, in many ways,
death is God's way of showing us how broken this world is, how devastating the realities is, and also pointing to the fact that it is broken. Because it's such a strange thought, a strange realization when that person's gone, you can still picture them. You can still wake up in the morning and expect to hear their voice and to expect to see them. And it's just a strange feeling, and it's not the way that as we examine the world, we know that it was intended. There's a reason I think there's just a strangeness that goes with death in it, because it wasn't a part of God's original plan. When God created Adam and Eve, they were created for eternity. So death entered the world, and yet our God, in His graciousness, in His love, made a plan to overcome death, to overcome the brokenness, the sin all around us, and that's by sending His Son, Jesus Christ, in His place. We would have kept on reading there in John, as Matt was preaching from earlier. Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me." That I have come for this purpose, and that's to overcome all the brokenness, all the sin, and the death. Just prior, He'd said it, "I am the resurrection and the life." So, as much as we recognize the brokenness, as much as we mourn, as much as we miss Grandma, or Aunt Peggy, or Mom, or just Peggy.
Peggy Joyce.
Margaret.
Yes.
She's not called Margaret, but for some reason, instead of, you know, you have nicknames to shorten it, but Grandpa likes to go the other way because, you know, he's Grandpa. But here's the promise. Jesus has overcome sin. He's overcome death. And the promise is for an eternity. So here in Revelation, we get a very wonderful and amazing picture of that eternity. It says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be His people. And God Himself will be this with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away.'" Our God, who in spite of our brokenness, our rebellion against Him, sent His Son to die for us in the hope of this new heaven, this new earth in which God dwells with us. And that's if we would be faithful, if we would trust in the promise of His Son, Jesus Christ. And that is exactly what Grandma did for so many years. It's so evident in the prayers, the conversations, the just time and dedication she spent going over that fact with each and every one of us. And I know myself included and many of us here can see the impact of her faith in our own. From a personal standpoint, I mean, I know God is God, and He will do what He will do, but He definitely used Grandma to lead me to Christ. And I know many of us have that same testimony. And so, we will get to celebrate, we will get to rejoice with her in the new heaven and the new earth. There's nothing greater than that. Heavenly Father, God, You are such a good God. Lord, we rebel against You. We do what we know we shouldn't. We rejoice in our own sin. We rejoice in our own selfishness. And yet, for some reason, You, as Psalm 103 that Grandma loved, says, your love goes beyond that. Lord, we thank you so much for Grandma. We thank you for her faith. We thank you that we know that she is in your arms. And Lord, we thank you that we know that she will be rejoicing for eternity in a new heaven and a new earth, dwelling with you. And Lord, I also pray as she would beg me and ask me to pray today for those here in attendance who don't know you. Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would soften their hearts, that they would see the brokenness of this world for what it is. They would see death as this ultimate sign of our rebellion against you, Lord. And Lord, that you would soften their hearts to repentance, that they would open up in faith and trust in you. I know that is what Grandma wanted so much for all of us here. And Lord, I just pray that your Holy Spirit would pour out upon us. Lord, we thank you for all that you do, for giving us this wonderful, wonderful woman, but most importantly, for giving us your son, Jesus, who she loved. And it's in his name we pray.
Cried a tear, you wiped it dry. I was confused, you cleared my mind. I sold my soul, you bought it back for me and held me up and gave me dignity. Somehow you needed me. You gave me strength to stand alone again, to face the world out on my own again. You put me high upon a pedestal, so high almost see eternity. You needed me, you needed me. And I can't believe it's you, I can't believe it's true. I needed you, and you were there. And I'll never I'd be a fool, 'cause I finally found someone who really cares. You held my hand when it was cold, when I was lost, you took me home. Gave me hope when I was at the end, and turned my life back into truth again. You even called me friend. You gave me strength to stand alone again, to face the out on my own again. You put me high upon a pedestal, so high that I could almost see eternity. You needed me, you needed me.
sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first
trophies. Yeah.
some bright morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to that home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. Thank you.